Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya. Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya. Namo om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Shimate Bhaktivedanta Swami Niti Namane Namaste Saraswata Deve Gauravani Prajadane Nivari Paschatade Shatarane Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Shivasati Gaur Bhaktivinoda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare. Reading from Srimad Bhagavatam 10, chapter 29, verse 14. Pranam Nishreya Sartaya Vyaktir Bhagavato Nirpa Avyayas Aprameyasya Nirgunasya Gunatmanaha. For humanity, Nishreyasa, of the highest benefit, Artaya, for the purpose, Vyakti, personal appearance, Bhagavata, of the Supreme Lord, Nripa, O King, Avyayasya, of Him who is inexhaustible, Aprameyasya, immeasurable, Nirgunasya, untouched by material qualities, Guna Atmana, the controller of the material modes. Translation, O King, the Supreme Lord is inexhaustible and immeasurable, and He is untouched by the material modes because He is their controller. His personal appearance in this world is meant for bestowing the highest benefit on humanity. Purport, since Lord Krishna descends to benefit mankind in general, why would He neglect innocent young girls who loved Him more than anyone else did? Although the Lord awards Himself to His pure devotees, He is avyaya, inexhaustible, because He is aprameya, immeasurable. He is also nirguna, free of material qualities, and thus those who intimately associate with Him are on the same spiritual platform. He is guna-atma, the controller or original personality behind the modes of nature, and it is specifically for this reason that He is free of them. In other words, because the modes of nature are His energy, they cannot act upon Him. So the question was asked about the gopis who seem to approach Krishna with kama, and yet the Lord Himself is absolute truth, pure, etc. So how is it that they these people approached him with material desire and were able to associate with him, they would have to become free of desire somehow or other to associate with him. So the question is now answered. And the beginning of the answer is here. So first there's a description of Supreme Lord. What is he? The Supreme Lord is makes his appearance for the benefit of everyone. So therefore, if he benefits people who are full of desire or with no desire, whatever, it's not a problem. We shouldn't criticize the Lord for helping everybody, even if they have all material desires. Of course, it was mentioned that some people approach with lust, some in fear, some in anger and hatred, etc. And even then, it is said, the Lord gives them benefit. The Lord benefits everyone. He benefits the asuras or the demons. If he kills them, they get benefit. And even if he doesn't kill them, they still get benefit by some association with the Lord, somehow or other. Now, on normal cases, if they show their anger in the material world, they don't get benefit. They simply suffer karmas as a result because they do activities against other living entities. So they get suffering for that. But in relation to the Lord, they get some benefit or somehow or other. So the Lord appears, manifests himself for everyone's benefit in the material world. Why is this? Because he is the perfect person. He manifests himself as Bhagavan, which means Bhagavan. The word Bhagavan means possessed of all auspicious qualities, all wonderful qualities. So the Lord has various supreme perfect qualities, good qualities, which he manifests in relation to the jivas in the spiritual world and in the material world. And it's through those qualities that there is there are pastimes and relationships with devotees through these different qualities. So therefore, naturally, because he's full of all wonderful qualities, he will act for everybody's benefit, not just the devotees, but even for the demons, etc. So it is not surprising because he has all wonderful qualities, so he can do that. So that is one meaning of Bhagavan. There's another meaning of Bhagavan, of course. Ba means the Bharta, which means one who nourishes and maintains everybody. So he maintains all the jivas in the material world by supplying them bodies, etc. He also nourishes particularly the devotees by encouraging their bhakti, etc. And in the spiritual world, of course, they are nourished by prema. So in all cases, the Lord nourishes all the jivas and satisfies their material desires or their spiritual desires. And he is, Ga stands for Gamita. He makes them achieve things. He makes them achieve the spiritual world. He gives them spiritual bodies. He gives them prema. So this is especially for the devotees. The Lord gives very special benedictions to them, eternal bliss, etc. And va means vas, to live. So the Lord lives in the devotee, and the devotees live in the Lord. And so the devotees live in the Lord means the Lord is always thinking of the devotees. And the Lord is in the devotees means that the devotees are always thinking of him. So in other words, one of the major features and qualities of the Lord is his attraction for the devotees. And therefore, he awards them spiritual world, spiritual bodies, bliss, etc., in the spiritual world, and continually nourishes the prema. So that's another meaning of Bhagavan. So naturally then, he is going to act for everybody's benefit. Nishriyasa artaya. He will act for everybody, and particularly for the devotees. But even for the non-devotees, he's not their enemy. He doesn't have hatred towards anybody, so he acts beneficially for everybody, even the neutral persons, even those who are inimical to him, like the asuras. So natural, because he is Bhagavan. And he is avyaya. Avyaya means dissipation, to decrease. Avyaya means he does not decrease in any way. So though he does activities, he does not decrease in energy. Though he lives eternally, he does not decrease in his qualities and stuff and become old, etc., inferior in any way. His intelligence does not decrease, his strength does not decrease, nothing decreases at all. So he continues in this same state, no matter what he does, eternally, without wasting away at all. So in other words, he maintains his wonderful qualities eternally. Aprameya means, prameya means measurable. So aprameya means immeasurable. We cannot measure him, which means ultimately unlimited. No beginning and no end. We cannot measure him in any way in time or space. So this is the one of the special qualities of the Lord. We speak of the jiva as being an anu, small particle. In that sense, measurable. The Supreme Lord is Vibhu. He's everywhere, all-pervading, so we cannot measure. Nothing can measure him. He's beyond all measuring instruments. So these qualities, therefore, he's avyaya and aprameya, indicate his unlimited qualities, size, etc., eternally. So there's no fear that in acting and performing activities for the devotees and others, that he'll ever decrease or waste away, etc. He's always full, perfect. And nirguna, he is beyond the material gunas, beyond material nature, which is stated because generally material nature is called faulty because it is unconscious and it's due to the gunas that we have ignorance, etc. And I'll consequently get karma and suffering in the material world. So the Lord is nirguna. He is beyond all of that. No material contamination, no ignorance, no karma, no suffering, etc. At any time, even if he appears within the material world, he is still nirguna. And gunatmana. So he's beyond the gunas, but at the same time, it says here he is made of the gunas. Gunatmana. His very self is the gunas. So this means that he is in control of the gunas of material nature at all times and able to control them. Not that he is influenced by them negatively at all. So he is the master of the gunas. Of course, the other meaning can be simply taken that he is composed of all wonderful qualities. So this is a description of the Supreme Lord. If he is of this nature, then what is wrong if he accepts everybody that approaches him in the material world? If they approach him out of kama, krodha, baya, sneha, whatever, negatively or positively, everybody can get some sort of benefit from the Lord. But we also know that scriptures say the Lord is neutral, sama, towards all jivas, but he is attracted to devotees. So there is some distinction. Huh? So obviously, if you approach with affection, then the Lord will act in one way and benefit the person. And if one acts with lust or anger or greed or whatever, the Lord will act in a different way. Nevertheless, he gives benefit to everybody. But, comparatively speaking, how he acts in relation to the devotees is superior. So we should not think that no matter how one approaches the Lord in hatred or in affection, one gets the same result. But definitely, one gets some benefit. That's all it means. So, this is not a bad quality for those. It's a good quality. He helps everybody. Even the worst person in the material world, he will somehow show us compassion on him in some way or other. So, therefore, the Lord is merciful to everyone, but he is especially merciful to the devotees. So those who act favorably towards the Lord, then they get better result. Now, those who act favorably, then they're also of various grades. We have those that are little favorable. They have a little faith. Well, they get all mixed ideas, misconceptions, doubts, etc. also. Still, the Lord acts favorably towards them because those persons are favorable towards the Lord. They have some faith. If that faith is increased and they have better knowledge of the Lord and they don't have such misconceptions about the Lord acts more on their behalf. Because the Lord says, as you surrender unto me, I respond accordingly. So the more devotion one has and the purer it is, the better the response of the Lord. So this is also a very logical type of response. According to the purity and strength of one's devotion, the Lord responds in a better manner. Therefore, we have extremes from the gross materialist who hates the Lord, and then we get one who's kind of neutral, then we have one who has a little faith, but a lot of misconceptions, then we have one with a little stronger faith, and less misconceptions, may have some material desires, then we get some people that are practicing pure bhakti, no material, they're trying to get rid of all their material desires. Simply, Lord, accept the Lord and serve him without material expectations at all. So this is what we call pure bhakti, or Suddha bhakti, or Uttama bhakti. So that is the best type of sadhana. And when that becomes perfect, by getting rid of all the anarthas, then it is called prema. It's also Uttama bhakti, but we call it prema. So that is the perfect state. So that is the state where one gets to associate with the Lord directly, as we see here in the 10th canto of Bhagavatam, the various associates of the Lord. They have prema, and they associate with the Lord directly. So, those who are on the lower levels don't get the same response from the Lord. They get some response, not that response. Again, direct relationship with the Lord. So, in this way, the Lord responds to everyone, and he gives everybody benefit, but according to one's attitude, the Lord responds differently. He responds differently for the asuras and demons, differently for the neutral persons, and differently for the different grades of devotees. And they get different results. So as I said, this is quite logical, that according to qualification, the Lord will give different results. But in any case, he gives benefit. Therefore, the next verse describes how one can approach the Lord with anger or fear or affection or friendliness, etc. There should always be a benefit for everybody. So we are familiar with the benefits that the devotees get. Ultimately, they go to the spiritual world, they get spiritual bodies, they associate with the Lord in prema, etc., and they get bliss. But what about the demons? So one approaches the Lord with anger, being angry at the Lord. How does that person get benefit from the Lord? Sometimes the Lord kills them. And we'll say, well, that's not beneficial. But some of them get liberation. So that's the goal of the Gyanis. So very quickly, without doing anything except hating the Lord, they get liberation. So on. So benefit. We see, of course, that some of these demons also get sarupya and salokya. They go to the spiritual world and they get a form, a spiritual form in which they can exist and serve in the spiritual world. So that is definitely a very merciful act of the Lord towards the demons. This, however, is a special quality of Krishna, not of the other forms of the Lord, that he does such things. So as I mentioned, Ramchandra or Nishirmadeva or others, when they kill demons, they give them some position in the material world where they can enjoy. Like Hiranyakasipu becomes Ravana, Ravana becomes Shishupala. But when Krishna kills the demons, then they get a place in the spiritual world or they get liberation. Very, very remarkable. So that is the benefit he gives even the demons. So this is not an act to discourage the devotees and say, okay, we should all become demons and get killed by the Lord. Rather, it is to show the mercy of the Lord. And if the demon gets this result, the devotees must get something much better than that. That's the idea. So yes, the Lord can award the demon someplace in the spiritual world, but the devotee will get something much better than that even. In other words, he will get a much better relationship with the Lord. He'll get more than sloki and sarupya. He'll get a very close relationship with the Lord. Therefore, the devotee should not be discouraged by that. But this shows the great mercy of the Supreme Lord even towards those who hate him or whatever. Why Krishna is so special as compared to Ramchandra and Nrsimhadev? They're all merciful, so why don't they all liberate the demons and whatever? So the answer is, of course, Krishna is Swayam Bhagavan, so naturally he shows more mercy than anybody else, but he's more attractive. So because he's more attractive, the demon who hates the Lord becomes very attracted to him. And therefore, his mind becomes concentrated on the Lord, even if it isn't hatred. It becomes absorbed in him more than previously. Of course, we find that Hiranyakasipu was, of course, hating Vishnu because Vishnu killed his brother. But then he became Ravana, and he hated the Lord again. And then he was killed by Rama. And then he became Shishupala, and again he hated the Lord. But when he hated the Lord as Krishna, he hated him more intensely because he was always thinking of him. This is described also in relation to Kamsa. Kamsa was thinking of Krishna all the time, when he's waking, when he's sleeping, when he's eating, etc. When is he going to come and kill me, etc. like that. And he was thinking of that beautiful form of Krishna all the time. So that had a very beneficial effect upon the demon, and the demon got purified by that. So that is why the demons get such a wonderful result when they're killed by the Supreme Lord, because they've been purified by that intense meditation on the Lord because of his all-attractive qualities, etc. So that's a special quality of Krishna to distinguish him from Rama or Nrsimhadev. And those other forms, Hiranyakasipu did not constantly think of Vishnu or whatever. or Nishimadev, and Ravana did not constantly think of Ramchandra or Vishnu in those forms. Hmm? But when Krishna appeared, then Shishupala was completely concentrating on Krishna. Hmm? So this is a remarkable feature of Krishna in relation to the demons. Huh? In any case, even if it's not Krishna, yes, the Lord doesn't hate those demons, and he kills them, and he gives them some advantage, a very, very good result. So this, of course, takes place when the Lord himself appears in the material world as avatar. Then this can happen. When the Lord's not there, of course, then there's no one, he can't kill anybody and liberate them in these ways or whatever, so those special effects of getting liberation by getting killed by the Lord aren't there. That's a special effect when the Lord is there. If one were to absorb oneself in the Lord somehow or other, even in hatred, even when the Lord's not personally present as avatar, etc., then even that would benefit one because it would purify one eventually. So if one is completely absorbed in the Lord, even negatively with anger and hatred, then one would eventually be purified by that. How is it possible? Nature of the Supreme Lord. But as I said, special for Krishna. Other forms don't even do that. Even if they personally meet Nishimadev or Rama, they don't get completely absorbed in them. So this is a special nature of Krishna. If one were to approach the Lord in anger and whatever and hatred, then still the benefit is there. If one does not have hatred as such, but one has material desires, that is better. So one approaches the Lord with material desires. That is what we call mixed bhakti. So the Lord accepts that, and he considers this person a devotee. Four types of devotees are there. Those who approach the Lord to get material benefits or to get rid of material suffering, etc. These are accepted by the Lord as devotees. So definitely a good result for that. But if they serve without those desires, then it's pure bhakti, they get better results. That is one level of question, answering the question. But of course, we also understand that the gopis themselves were already purified. It wasn't they had to become purified through kama. They were already on the highest level. But they expressed themselves through prema, very strong prema, in Madhurya Rasa. So that is not material at all. That prema in Madhurya Rasa is purely spiritual. So there's no fault in that at all, and there's no necessity of becoming purified to approach the Lord with that at all. Rather, opposite. The Lord readily accepts those devotees on that level. So there's no contamination at all in their approach to the Lord. That is the gopis' approach to the Lord.
We find in the other yugas, the Lord is coming directly and killing the demons, and demons are getting some type of liberation. The question may ask, in Kali Yuga, the demons don't even get that mercy. Of course, they can turn Mahaprabhu's mercy to Mahamantra they're getting by preaching. But Lord doesn't come here directly to annihilate. The other yugas, like Ram killed Ravan, Krishna, Shishupal,
They didn't get liberation either.
They didn't get
liberation. No. That's only when Krishna comes they get liberation. So when Lord Chaitanya comes, they get Madhurya Prema, something even better. So even aparadis, by surrendering to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and chanting the holy name, they can get love of Radha and Krishna, which is not just get sarupya or whatever like that. They can get highest level of prema. Of course, that means they also have to reform and, you know, become devotees, etc. But the power of the name of the Lord is such that you can even take the aparadis and purify them.
Maharaj, we see demons are hatred towards the Lord. But atheists are neither hatred nor favorable. They don't accept it. So do they also get benefit of the by Lord's appearance or when Lord is there?
If they get killed by the Lord,
no,
definitely.
But atheists, they don't accept. Neither they are favorable nor hatred.
Well. Yeah, so it depends. If they concentrate on the Lord, fine. If they don't, are not aware of the Lord, nothing happens at all, as in the case of most people in the world. So this is approaching the Lord in anger, hatred, affection, etc. So if they're not approaching at all, then there's no question of it. Question may be asked, when the Lord allows the demons to attack his dear devotees and then later kills the demons, what mistake have the sincere devotees made which makes them suffer so much from the demons? Could this be avoided? Well, in the case of the stories in the Bhagavatam, much of this so-called attack of the demons is on devotees. It's not really, we can't associate it with karma or anything like that. For instance, the whole Pandavas afflicted by the Kauravas, etc. It is no karma at all because they're Nityasiddha devotees. So it's an arrangement of the Lord for certain pastimes. And similarly, if the demons come to Vrindavan and cause some affliction, whatever, again, no karma for the devotees of Vrindavan. So this again is for pastimes.
We see this in the case of Shishupala and Kamsa. When Shishupala also knew that who is going to kill him, and Kamsa also knew that who is going to kill him. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't happen for Hiranyakashipu and Hiranyaksha. Because of that, they didn't know that who is going to kill him, so they could not concentrate their mind on the Lord. Oh. They could not concentrate because Kamsa knew that Krishna is going to kill me, although Kamsa doesn't know how is the form of Krishna. But Shishupala knows that Krishna is going to kill me.
Yeah, I think he had previous memory. He remembered that in previous lifetime, Vishnu had killed him. So therefore, and Kamsa was Kalanami or something like that. So they had some previous memory of a previous lifetime of hatred of Vishnu, at least.
Jatishvara, you're saying?
Huh?
Jatishvara. Sanskrit is Jatishvara. Means who remembers his past and something like that.
Yeah.